Here's Dr. Berger.
Thank you, Mark. Boy, you're all so nice to clap before I even started. That's really encouraging. Okay. So tonight's presentation, I hope you have a little bit of fun and a little bit of learning. And I hope it's interesting. I'll judge by how many people are asleep before they hit their cars tonight, right? Okay, so we're going to start. This is me. I'm fellow of the American Society of Addiction Medicine and an unabashed supporter of abstinence-based 12-step recovery. Otherwise, I've got nothing to declare. I'm not owned by any drug companies or hospital systems or anything else, so what you see is what you get here. We're going to have four different objectives. I can count still. The first one is to learn the history of opiates in medicine. Second one is to understand opiate addiction as a brain disease. And that's an actual shot of an opium den in the late 1800s. The third one is to talk about issues in the use of opiates to treat chronic pain. And the fourth one is to discuss medical treatments for opiate addiction. So let's start. This is a cover of a paper translating the writings of Hippocrates and Galen. Hippocrates, of course, a Greek physician, and Galen, a Roman physician. Galen actually ruled medicine until about the year 1600. His thought predominated, but opiates were used even before they were writing. It's as old as the poppy. And there's the papaver somniferum. The somniferum, the somnus means sleep, and ferus is a Latin word which means to make. So this is a sleep-making poppy, and I'm going to be going through some names and some language translations here, just because it's one of my loves, as you could conceive from the introduction. This is, if you take all those pretty petals off, this is the poppy bulb, or the poppy head. All of the little pretty petals used to be here. And if you simply let this thing dry out and then cut it open, what you get is poppy seeds. If, on the other hand, while it's still unripe or growing, you score it, you get this latex right here. And this is opium, named after the Greek word for sap, which is opion. And prior to the so-called scientific revolution of the 1800s, it was the only available narcotic. So what was it used for? It was used for headache, it was used for pain, including pain from surgery, and it's used to treat diarrhea and insomnia. So those were the medical uses. There were, of course, other uses as well. Opium was usually taken orally, and after the New World was discovered and tobacco was introduced, it could be mixed with tobacco and smoked, or just smoked plain, as Western Europeans became inventive. The Paracelsus in the 1500s put opium into alcohol and made a substance called laudanum, which, I don't know, anybody hear that word before? Some people have. Okay, so laudanum, this part, lauda, comes from laudare, which is a Latin word meaning anybody?
To praise,
right. So this is Paracelsus's praiseworthy substance, okay? And if you look, now people on and off, if they added all kinds of stuff to laudanum besides opium and alcohol, but basically it's tincture of opium. And it's an 80 proof alcohol, which is wonderful in and of itself. But then there's 45 and a half grains of opium per ounce. Now, if you work that out at 62.4 milligrams per grain, it's 2.9 grams of opium in an ounce of laudanum. So 2.9 grams. Now, if you figure that about 10% of that is actually morphine, then you're really talking about 290 grams of morphine. If you figure that the liver removes probably 80 to 90% of it before it ever hits the body and the brain, then you're really only getting about 29 grams of morphine per ounce. And you know, even in the old days, that's not peanuts, right? 29 grams of morphine per ounce. So what happened? You get opium addicts, right? Who's this? This is Mary Todd Lincoln, the wife of Abraham Lincoln, who was an opium addict. And this, for all of you literature majors?
Coleridge.
It's Coleridge, right, the poet, who wrote The Rime of the Ancient Mariner, also an opiate addict. And there are tons of opiate addicts as you go through history and look, especially in the creative arts. Opium itself, however, is kind of this grand mixture of a bunch of different alkaloids, at least 50, and only two of them have any kind of analgesic property, and they are morphine and codeine. So this is the difference. If you look at the difference here, is that codeine has this little methyl group here, and morphine just has a hydrogen. That's the only difference between these two molecules. For those of you who like molecules, it's kind of fun. So this is morphine in all its glory, and morphine comes only from this poppy, Papaver somniferum. And there are different varieties of the poppy called cultivars, and they have been bred to produce as little as 0.04% morphine or as high as 26% morphine by dry weight. Morphine, when it was discovered, was named after Morpheus, the Greek god of dreams. And lots of people are still worshiping this god today. Throughout the 1800s and into the 20th centuries, people tried to improve morphine. And by the 1920s, two different drugs, each producing narcotic effects, were developed. One was diacetyl morphine, and the other was hydromorphone. So let's look at them. This is diacetyl morphine. Now, a couple of interesting things about this, although it's not so nice, is that if you look, you know, laudanum and morphine all have names that go back to the Latin or the Greek. This one doesn't. This has the name hero in it, and it was put there on purpose. And the reason that it doesn't have a Latin or Greek name, although it was brought out in the late 1800s, 1898 here in America, was that it was marketed directly to the public. It was not marketed to the physicians for use in medicine. It was marketed directly to the public and was available over the counter as a cough suppressant. And within a few years, the newspapers were rampant with tales of people becoming addicted to this drug. So much so that by 1914, an international consortium had come together to regulate the sale and manufacture and possession of narcotics. And in America, that translated into this Harrison Narcotics Tax Act, which used the taxation power of the federal government to basically bring all narcotics back into the realm of only being used under a prescription by a medical prescriber. So it became illegal for a private individual to possess a narcotic without a prescription. It became illegal to sell or manufacture them unless it was for a medicinal purpose. Now, the second drug that was developed from morphine was hydromorphone, and that was developed in 1924. So this is after the Harrison Narcotic Act, very quickly brought to market. There wasn't any kind of lengthy process with this one. And this was dilaudid, again, marketed to the medical people. Here's laudana, laudare, again, which means to praise, and di means more, twice as praiseworthy. And if you look at the, I don't know if you can read this well, it basically has a disclaimer that you can only possess it or if you were given a prescription by a licensed prescriber. So that's dilaudid. It's not a new medicine at all. It's an old, old medicine, back to the 1920s, so almost 90 years old at this point. Now the other molecule that comes out of opium is codeine. And that word comes from the Greek. It means poppy head. And it was also naturally an opium isolated in 1832, so a few years after morphine, and is still available over the counter in Canada as 222 tablets, which have 8 milligrams of codeine in them, along with some other caffeine and acetaminophen. Now, codeine was also improved back in 1920, and they manufactured a drug which was brand named Hycoan. Again, you know, the drug companies are not too subtle. Codeine, high codeine, right? Anybody know what this drug was? Marketed first in 1943. During World War II, when restriction to the opiate fields became a little bit problematic and more pain relievers were needed. Anybody know what that one is? That's Vicodin, hydrocodone. And it's the thought behind where Vicodin came from is if you look at hydrocodone compared to codeine, its parent molecule, it's 6 times more potent than codeine. And 6 in Roman numerals is what?
VI.
So VI codeine becomes Vicodin, right? Okay. Again, not a new drug at this point in time, but 70 years old. Still around. So this is papaver somniferum. This is papaver bracteatum. You know, I can't tell these things apart. If you look at papaver somniferum, pictures of it, they assume all kinds of different colors and shapes. So it's impossible to really look at these without being a horticulturist. What's the use of this thing? This thing is the source of a molecule called thebaine. Thebaine, although it occurs naturally in opium, has no analgesic properties. When it's given to men and women, it produces nothing but seizures. However, it's been used by the pharmaceutical industry to make almost every opiate on the market in this day and age. Why is it named thebaine? It's named thebaine because it's named after the capital of opium production and distribution in the ancient world, which was, anybody? Thebes in Egypt. So this is predating Hippocrates by centuries. So this is the summary, basic summary. You'll be tested on this after the lecture. Anybody who doesn't get it all right can't leave. I'm sorry. So no, but morphine then has been maneuvered and manipulated to produce hydromorphone, dilaudid, and diacetyl morphine, which is heroin. Codeine has been manipulated to produce hydrocodone or Vicodin or Nortab or Lorset or whatever you want to call. Thebaine actually has 3 distinct groups. The first group is highly addictive narcotics, oxycodone and oxymorphone. The second group is mixed agonist antagonists, which are nalbuphine, which isn't used much anymore, and buprenorphine, which has just experienced a resurgence. And a third group, which is pure antagonists. So these drugs, naloxone and naltrexone, possess absolutely no narcotic activity at all. They simply block out any narcotics from being usable, which was useful later, we'll see. So we're going to move from there, after having exhausted all of that, to talk about opiate addiction as a brain disease. And I'm going to go back to 1956 with James Olds writing an article in Scientific American called Pleasure Centers of the Brain. Now, you have to take yourself back to the 1950s. In 1950s, things like love and excitement and sadness were felt to be things of the soul. James Olds says, you know, perhaps there's some kind of physiological correlates to these emotions. These are not just simply things of the soul. Maybe there's also something to do with the brain here. So he wanted to do some research investigating that. And specifically, what he decided to do was to see if there were areas of the brain where where animals might want to, that he could stimulate that would cause animals to seek the stimulus again. So this is what he did. This is a picture from his actual paper in Scientific American. This is a radiograph of the of a mouse with an electrode implanted deep into the brain. The references are going to be posted afterwards, Jess, is that right, on the website. So if you want to read any of this stuff, it's really fascinating reading and quite understandable. This is another picture. This was actually a series of three different experiments. And in the third experiment, what he did was he planted the electrode right here into the rat's brain, put the rat in a cage, and the cage was allowed, the rat was allowed free roam all over where it would over the cage. In the cage was this pedal. Now, when the pedal was pushed down, there was a little microampere of current that would come through here down into the electrode, down into the animal's brain, and turn on wherever the electrode happened to lie. Okay? So what James Olds wanted to know is, by stimulating this area, can we make the animal want to do it again? So the first area he tried was in the rhinencephalon. And sure enough, he was able to get the rat to do it again. It would do it from 200 times an hour up to 200 times an hour. It's 3 times per minute. Press that pedal. When he moved the electrode a little bit from the rhinencephalon down into the median forebrain bundle, the rat would do it up to 5,000 times an hour. 80 times per minute, more than once every second, and would continue to press the pedal until it fell over from exhaustion. So he decided to say, well, let's, what goes on next? So he decided that he would test to see how strong this stimulation thing, experiment that he put together was, and he took the rat out of the cage for 24 hours and starved it. Didn't give it any food, and also didn't give it any water. And after 24 hours, he let it back into the cage. It had to go down a ramp. And halfway down, the ramp divided. And at the end of one end of the ramp was a bowl of food and a dish of water. And at the end of the other end of the ramp was the pedal. And take a guess where the rat went.
The pedal.
Every time. So he said, I got a defective rat. No. So he did it again with more rats, and every time he did it, he got the same results. So this formed the very beginning. This is the first time we've ever been able to understand at all addiction is kind of a brain disease. It has to do with this system in the brain right here called the mesolimbic dopamine pathway. And this pathway has radiations here to this place called the nucleus accumbens, and we test on this too. And over here, that's got to do with, we think, where the actual pleasurable sensation is experienced. And then down here into the amygdala, which has to do with emotions and regulation of emotions in the limbic system. But look also up here into the prefrontal and frontal cortex, which are the areas of our brain which are involved in planning and reasoning and judgment. Of interest is down here where it all starts out. This is called the ventral tegmental area, and that's where opiates hit the system, right at the right there, and turn it on. So everything goes up through here. The brain learns that something wonderful has happened and wants to do it again. Creates that desire. This is not on a conscious level. This is on a subconscious level. These are all old structures of the brain. If you go right into this area here, this is called the periaqueductal gray area right here. And if you were to put morphine or heroin or any kind of narcotic in that area, you produce pain relief or analgesia. So addiction and analgesia are produced in separate areas of the brain. However, they're both run by mu receptors. Although the different subtypes of mu receptors, it's really just not important for our purposes. They're both run by mu receptors. These drugs turn on mu receptors. It's impossible to relieve pain with an opiate without also beginning to produce addiction.
So is it the amygdala that's initially?
I'm sorry?
Is it the amygdala that's initially stimulated?
Well, the amygdala receives stimulation from this, but so does all these other places, okay? Which is why people feel peaceful and kind of you know, if there's any depression going on or there's any anxiety going on, it's all relieved by the administration of opiates. But again, I want to emphasize that you can't separate producing analgesia and producing addiction. Some people are more susceptible to the addictive effects of the opiates than others, but you, with everybody, over time will develop this addictive pathways and the disease we call addiction. And just of some further interest, there's a little place back here called the locus coeruleus. Now, if you look at, there's opiate receptors all through the brain, which is one thing that I think makes opiate withdrawal so tough to do, is that the opiates influence almost everything the brain does. But over here, this little place called locus coeruleus is a place which is where the withdrawal generates from. So when you think about opiate addiction, the point that I want to make with that is that there are at least three different important centers of the brain that are involved when you're talking about opiate addiction. One is the analgesia, one is the addiction, and the third is the withdrawal, and they're in three separate areas of the brain, all run by mu receptors, okay, which is what these drugs activate. So we're going to talk about issues in the use of opiates to treat chronic pain. Now, where does all this start? Why are we concerned? This is from 2010. I'm lazy. The slide from 2011 hasn't changed, so I didn't bother to change it. This is drug overdoses, okay? And over here is heroin and other narcotics. And over here, from here on down, are prescription drug overdoses in the United States. And in 2010, 2011, the last years that we have any kind of data from, prescription drug overdose for the first time in the history of the United States has achieved number one status as accidental deaths, overtaking motor vehicle accidents as a number one cause of death. Where did it all start? In 1986, a fellow by the name of Portnoy in New York authored an article about treating chronic non-malignant pain. And again, these will be available on the website, the references. Dr. Portney reported on 38 patients. He based his research on a one-paragraph letter in the New England Journal of Medicine. This letter looked at was a retrospective study looking at the treatment of an acute pain episode in the hospitals. Like, somebody comes in and they've had an appendicitis, they get treated with opiates, how many of those people are going to get addicted? And that study found a negligible amount of people getting addicted to opiates in that kind of setting. Dr. Portney extrapolated from that, he did a series, again, of 38 patients alone. This is not, this is really amazing to me. But did 38 patients, and on the basis of his study of 38 patients, said that we can use opiates chronically for non-malignant pain, that's non-cancer pain, so back pain, leg pain, arm pain, you name it, hair pain, and it's going to be perfectly fine and you're not going to have any problems. You're not going to have any side effects from the treatments and you're not going to have any addiction produced. This is what we got in the late 90s. Was this thing coming at us from the regulatory agencies telling us that pain was a vital sign and we needed to assess it, just like we did any other vital signs. This is what happened, this explosion of narcotics. This drug, Sublimaze, was introduced when I still had black hair, and it was used primarily in surgery to produce pain relief during surgery, a very potent narcotic. In the late 1990s, it went off-label. Again, Dr. Portney's group had done their work very well now, and they had actually been commissioned by the American Pain Society to write guidelines on pain management. So when it went generic, within years, a few years, look what we had, a patch, a sublingual spray, a nasal spray, a tablet for the cheek, tablet under the tongue, like nitroglycerin, right, and a lollipop, besides the original intravenous use. And this drug just took off right away. People were making a fortune out of it. Another instance of the greed that went on at that time, this drug, Numorphan, was introduced developed in 1914 and marketed in 1959 in the United States as new morphine. Again, really new morphine, right? It was withdrawn in 1972. What was going on in 1972 that might cause a drug to be withdrawn? What's that? Yeah, it was the second opiate epidemic. So the first one was in the late 1800s, early 1900s. The next opiate epidemic in America was during the 1960s and 70s when the veterans were coming back from Indochina addicted to heroin. And in the midst of the war on drugs with Lyndon Baines Johnson, the pressure became enormous and Endopharmaceuticals withdrew the drug from the market. But with Dr. Portney's help, they were able to reintroduce it again in 2006. They renamed it Opana for opiate analgesia, right? And it rapidly became the drug of choice when the feds put the screws on OxyContin, at which time, instead of withdrawing it, which they had previously done, which tells you something about where society is between then and now, it was simply reformulated.
Whatever happened to that doctor?
With what?
Whatever happened to Dr. Portney?
Well, we're getting there. What would you like to have happen to Dr. Portney?
He's on a yacht.
Okay, so you can go to the Wall Street Journal and just Google in pain drug champion has second thoughts and you'll get his article. Dr. Portney had second thoughts in December of 2012. Okay, again, in December of 2012, he states that based on the standards of 2012, prior years of teaching were misinformation. Now think about this, 30 years of telling doctors that to prescribe opiates was safe, you wouldn't produce addiction, you wouldn't have any side effects. And he's going to call it misinformation 30 years later. He says there was no data on the effectiveness of long-term opiate prescribing for chronic cancer, non-cancer pain. And then, all the time, all 30 years, he is receiving massive amounts of funding from the pharmaceutical industry. This is a shame. This makes me ashamed to be a doctor to say this. But truth is truth, right? Yeah. What's that?
Whether the sample size of 38 could be considered too low.
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't even a randomized controlled trial. It was simply a simple series that he did, and then it was based on his word that everything was okay. I mean, this is ridiculous. To completely overthrow 2,000 years of medical wisdom with a 38-patient study is just ridiculous from my standpoint. So,
isn't that what seems to be the impact of longer studies on a lot of medication, which is then taken, stated by the CDC that it's having worse effects on certain...
Yeah, well, let's take a look, okay, because we're going to go on this, because I haven't done any really fancy research during my lifetime, because I like to take care of people. I don't like to do research. Again, this reference, this is a nice article written by a physician reviewing this whole incident, and I think is very balanced and very fair and also very condemnatory of the whole thing. But what I want to talk about is the experience that I've had and we've had at Brighton treating people with opiate addiction. And this is treating all kinds of opiate addicts, prescription drug users, recreational drug users, people with chronic pain, people without chronic pain. So what do we see? What we see is that oftentimes people feel better after they're off their opiates. People with chronic pain feel better off the opiates besides people without chronic pain taking off opiates. In fact, back in the day when I started, every treatment was 28 days. And what I would see in 28 days is for those people who made it through treatment, through the detox, and we didn't do detox real well back then, but for people who were able to make it through the detox, 90% or 9 out of every 10 people would tell me at the end of 28 days that their pain was either no worse or better than it had been when they were taking all the drugs that they came in. These are chronic pain patients. And that was pretty much split half. Half would say, I'm feeling better than I felt in years, and half would say, well, I don't feel any worse when I was taking all those medicines. And why is that? Why would that be? There are a number of different reasons. The first is opiates have side effects. I mean, these are not pleasant things. Constipation, loss of libido, sex drive, not able to have an erection, loss of periods, insomnia, and sleepiness, right? So don't have too much and you can't sleep. You have too much and you can't sleep, right? Terrible thing. Trouble peeing, which hardly anybody ever talks about, but males more than females. Nausea and vomiting, yeah, that means it's really good stuff, right? Itching and headache, okay? So people taking opiates for chronic headache, opiates produce headache. I mean, give me a break here. So opiate side effects produce a lot of pain. So that's one reason people get off of them. They don't have any side effects, they feel better. The second thing is that withdrawal symptoms are oftentimes confused for the original problem. So if somebody, for example, is being prescribed opiates for irritable bowel syndrome, they take opiates, they get constipated, they stop taking opiates, they have diarrhea. I mean, what's their irritable bowel or their ulcerative colitis, and what's the opiate producing? People with headaches, again, if they're taking opiates, because headaches are part of opiate withdrawal as well. So what's the original headache and what's withdrawal headache? Back pain, a 20-year-old heroin user coming off of heroin who has absolutely no physical problems at all is going to have a back that aches like anything for 3 or 4 days. So when you have back pain and you're taking opiates for back pain, how do you know what's your original back pain? How do you know what's the withdrawal from the opiates? So you clear out all the withdrawal symptoms, and lots of times people discover to their surprise that the body actually does heal over a period of time, and things are actually better. A third reason is that depression oftentimes accompanies chronic opiate use, and this is from Grinspoon and Balakar, back in the 80s, writing in the textbook of psychiatry, that 80% of opiate users in 2 years of daily opiate use are going to meet DSM, at that time, three criteria for major clinical depression. And that's not because they have a major depressive clinical disorder. It's because the opiates themselves have produced depression. And what does depression do to pain? Lots of literature out now that says that what happens is pain is worsened by depression. So the depression gets worse, the pain gets worse, the pain gets worse, the depression gets worse. I mean, you can't do more, you get more isolated, more withdrawn, you feel more disabled, you can't, which makes your depression worse, which makes the pain worse, which makes, I mean, it's just a downward spiral here. So again, oftentimes this happens very quickly, usually within about a week or so, people coming off of opiates, a lot of the depression begins to resolve right away. Not to speak of not having to go out and pay the hitman or the dope man every day, huh? Fourth reason is that chronic opiate administration can cause an imbalance between the centers in the brain that regulate pain experiences. And they do it in such a way that as you increase the dose of the narcotic, people actually begin to feel more pain. We call that opioid-induced pain. I'm not going to bore you with this part. And there are two really important things that happen. Because pain is actually facilitated, and we see this probably in about 25% of people using opiates who have chronic pain, pain sensations is actually facilitated. So that small painful sensations, like, for example, touching somewhere around where the injured part is, all of a sudden becomes hugely painful. That's called hyperalgesia. And the second thing is that things which normally don't produce pain, things like wearing clothes or getting stroked on the skin, become dysphoric, unpleasant sensations which produce pain, and that we call allodynia. And that's all got to do with all of this chronic long-term opiate administration. Another reason is that it simply isn't normal to live without pain. I'm going to tell you a little story out of my own experience, my own personal experience about this. I have a father who's still alive, thank God. He's 91 years old. And at the age of 88, he broke his ankle. Now, you wouldn't think that would be so bad, except my dad's a post-polio syndrome patient. He had polio in 1951. And he also has pretty bad spinal stenosis. And so that as a result of that, he walks like this. And when you break an ankle and you walk like that, all of a sudden you can't walk very well. So he was didn't need a surgery or anything. They just needed some rest, so they put him in a nursing home. And he'd been there for 6 weeks, and at 6 weeks I got a call from the people saying, we need to come and talk with us. So I went and talked with them, and they said, you know, your dad just isn't getting better. He's in terrible pain all the time. He can't walk. You're going to have to look for a nursing home to put him in. So I'm scratching my head, calling my brothers and sisters, talking with my mom, who was still alive at the time, and trying to figure, and then when I stopped by to see him a couple days later, and I'd been working a little bit late, and I came by around 10 o'clock, and there's my dad lying flat in bed, getting ready to go to sleep for the night. Except, you know what? My dad hadn't laid flat in bed for 15 years. Because of his spinal stenosis, he had to sleep in a lazy boy. Because every time he laid flat, his back hurt like the dickens. So I said to him, what's going on? Well, they'd given him his Vicodin, right? Six times codeine, at 9 o'clock, and by 10 o'clock, they cranked the bed down and had him in a quite unnatural posture for himself. And of course, what would happen then is he'd wake up at 2 o'clock, so what would they do?
More Vicodin,
because he's in terrible pain. And then he'd wake up in the morning in terrible pain, right? So I called the nursing home director. I talked with the physical therapist. We talked with the nurse's staff. I said, talked with my dad. I said, you know, Dad, you want to come home. You got to stop the Vicodin. He said, that's not a problem. He's one of those lucky people, you know? So anyhow, he started sleeping in his normal position again, and he was home in 2 weeks. And he's been home for 3 years. He hasn't needed a nursing home. But pain is the gift that nobody wants. It lets you know your boundaries. When people are given opiates for chronic pain and the doctor tells them, well, if you're having some pain, all you need to do is take an extra Vicodin or some immediate release oxycodone or some Percocet or something for breakthrough pain, right? What are we teaching people? We're teaching them to ignore what their body can and can't do. And we're really putting them further along the road to addiction. We're asking them to rely on a drug to help them do what they want to do. And the last thing about using opiates to treat chronic pain is that it really doesn't address the real issues in chronic pain. So somebody comes in with chronic pain because they've been in a motor vehicle accident or a motorcycle accident, and they've got a leg and they can hardly walk. You know, pain is, I hate to say it, but pain is one of the least of the issues. I mean, there's issues like, how am I going to earn a job? How am I going to earn any money from now on? I can't play sports anymore. Can I even have sex anymore? And all of those things that we define ourselves by, the things that we do and the things that we're able to do, all of a sudden are lost. And what really cures people with chronic pain is to begin to accept their limitations and learn to live life fully as they are. This is another nice book called The Anatomy of Hope, written by a physician called Jerome Groopman, who is an oncologist. And it's really a talk about hope and chronic illness. But what I really like about this is that one of the chapters talks about his own experience with back pain. And he'd never got better because he was too preoccupied with trying to keep out of pain until he went to see a physical therapist at Harvard who told him that he was worshiping the volcano god of pain and would he please stop doing it. And he did, and he got better. Not riding a horse better, but he got better. So the last thing I want to talk about then is to talk about the medical treatment of addiction. So we're going to talk about two drugs, Vivitrol and Suboxone. Okay, so again, this is thebaine. It goes to norbuprenorphine, which is then taken to buprenorphine. So this is the molecule Suboxone, right? It's this one right here, group two, mixed agonist, antagonist. Suboxone has two drugs in it. One is a buprenorphine, the other is a drug called naloxone. We're going to talk about naloxone for a minute. Naloxone was manufactured by Sankyo Pharmaceuticals, introduced in the 1960s as a treatment for opioid overdose to save all the vets returning from the war in Indochina who were overdosing on heroin. Okay, so that's why it was introduced. It's a pure narcotic antagonist. So what's it doing in Suboxone? I mean, it's not a narcotic. It's not the first time it's been used this way. There's a drug called Toluene. Anybody here old enough to remember Toluene? Got a few old timers, yeah. Teas and blues, anybody? Yeah, toluene and pyrbenzamine, right? And people were, this was during the early 1980s when there was, again, part of the war on drugs had made closed off almost all the heroin supply. And so people were trying to get prescription narcotics to substitute for the heroin. And one of the things that some inventive street chemists came up with was using toluene with a pyrbenzamine. And what the pyrbenzamine would do would be to boost toluene, which wasn't really all that great a euphorogenic substance, and so you could get a decent high out of it. So the pharmaceutical company, Sanofi, reacted by trying to put naloxone into the toluene so that people wouldn't be able to crush the tablets and inject them, figuring that if they did, they'd get the opiate blocker, which would hit them first rather than the toluene. Yeah, it wasn't successful. Anybody use toluene these days? No, never did come back. But that's why they put it into Suboxone, was with the hope that it would reduce or eliminate abuse of the drug. Okay. So buprenorphine itself, which is the narcotic ingredient in Suboxone, was developed by Reckitt before they became Reckitt Benckiser in the 1980s and was introduced as a pain medicine, was a flop. It was introduced as a flop because it has a ceiling effect to it. You can't use other narcotics when you're using it. And it also, if you give it to somebody that you didn't know was an opiate addict, all of a sudden they get really sick from it. So it really didn't work real well. Someone at Reckitt Benckiser said to themselves, well, maybe we can use this differently. Maybe we could introduce this as a treatment for opiate dependency. So they went through a rather long process working with the feds to get it approved for opiate dependency. And when it was marketed in 2003 as a treatment for opiate dependency, that's when the data waiver came out, this is what they said. No high because it's only a partial agonist. Has a tight affinity for the mu receptor, which means that you can't use other narcotics when you're using it. So it's going to prevent, if somebody's got a heroin addiction and they're on Suboxone, they're not going to be able to get high on heroin. It has a long half-life, which means that you only need to dose it once a day. And I love this one. This is from Bickel et al., 1968. Slow dissociation of buprenorphine from the receptor results in a long duration of effect and also confers another advantage in that when the drug is withdrawn and the abstinence syndrome is rarely seen because of the long time taken for the drug to come off the receptor. So let's look what our experience was, because we used Suboxone for a while at Brighton. So partial agonist means you can't get high, right? So if you look at HGB writing on Arrowhead, I'm just going to read this off now. I was prescribed 8 milligrams of Suboxone per day, which is quite expensive without insurance, and went home as quick as I could and slid a pill under my tongue. Within 40 minutes, my withdrawal symptoms were completely gone, and I was in such a great mood. That's the amygdala coming out again, right? I had so much energy, but this sure did and does feel like being high on a nice dose of Vicodin. I got home, just grabbed the lawnmower, mowed all the grass, came inside and said to myself, now what, with all this energy? I called my wife. Of course, I didn't tell her how high I felt. Telling her, this is the greatest drug in the world, and my withdrawal symptoms are gone. I just took another 4 milligrams about 2.5 hours ago and feeling very high. Hard to concentrate and even type this, and I've read so much that this doesn't get you high. A friend said it got him a little high the first time and then just felt normal afterwards, so who knows, but right now this is unreal. And actually, my experience in using this drug is that almost everybody feels at least a little bit high almost all the time on Suboxone. Why not? I mean, it's kicking in the mesolimbic dopamine pathway. Next thing they said was that it has a tight affinity for the mu opiate receptor, which meant that other opiates were going to be blocked from acting, but you only get that blockade at a dose of 16 milligrams a day, which means in order to continue that kind of protection, you have to take 16 milligrams of buprenorphine a day for the rest of your life. And it's only effective for opiates. I mean, it doesn't do anything as far as blocking Xanaxes and clonopins and alcohol and marijuana and all the rest of that stuff. And it only blocks it if you take it every day. They said that it would only be needed to be dosed once a day, but we rapidly found that people rarely tolerated once a day dosing. Most people needed at least twice a day doping. Yeah, that's probably Freudian there. And then most people were doing at least three or four times a day. And they said it wouldn't produce any withdrawal. Again, from Arrowhead, this is from Borderline writing. Let me just read it again. But there is a downside. This stuff has, without any doubt, worse withdrawal than heroin. The withdrawal feels different and lasts about 4 weeks. My doctor says this is not uncommon, but still on the bad side of the withdrawal spectrum. The first week withdrawal, this was after tapering down to 1 milligram, was hell. No sleep at all for the entire week. I spent 7 days in bed sweating rivers and changing clothes constantly. The anxiety was unbearable. All I wanted in the world was a Xanax. Great. After that week, I started to regain my ability to sleep, but it was a full month before I could really sleep through a night without sweats. I ended up getting seriously into other drugs in my desire to stay away from opioids. My use of ketamine and DXM was seriously dangerous and very irresponsible every day or night for 3 to 4 months after quitting Subutex. Either this heavy use of dissociatives or the withdrawal itself triggered my first manic episode, but what a nut I became, but this is another story altogether. Anyway, 6 months later, I relapsed on a whim, crashed a car, and got back on Subutex. And here I am, unsure if I will ever try to quit buprenorphine maintenance. I go to work every day. I'm safe and numb, and I don't know where to go from here, and I don't like where I am. What a sad place to be. And they said that naloxone would prevent or discourage abuse of the drug. Well, yeah, it probably discourages it, and the literature bears that out. However, I need to tell you, we've admitted more than one IV Suboxone user to Brighton for treatment. So what did we see over the course of the first about 8 years of use? Number one, it produces euphoria. Number two, it has a withdrawal syndrome associated with it. It's being abused. And in fact, in a recent article in February in the Journal of Addiction Medicine, over 60% of people going to a physician requesting Suboxone for the first time, prescription for the first time, 60% of those people had used Suboxone illegally prior to that physician visit. It's being sold and traded on the streets for money, other drugs, and crushed to tablets used intranasally or intravenously. Of course, you can use it to beat a drug test, right? Get off the heroin for 3 or 4 days, let it clear out of your system, go on buprenorphine, because most people don't test for the buprenorphine, and then get back on your drug of choice again. And we had patients calling in early for their prescriptions. You know, it got lost, it was stolen, my dog ate it, and so on and so forth. And the patients were giving the drugs to friends and family members, which is, of course, is a felony under federal law. One of the things about giving it to friends and family members, and I saw high school kids doing this quite frequently when they prescribed Suboxone. And Suboxone is particularly addictive in the opiate-naive patients. So somebody who's never taken an opiate before, taking Suboxone is just like taking morphine or Vicodin or codeine or any other narcotic. And in fact, if you look back through history in the 1960s when Reckitt released buprenorphine in England, it was marketed under the brand name Temgesic. And the Temi epidemic took place pretty rapidly in England right after that. But we didn't learn from that. It's difficult to be drug-free when you're taking an opiate. I mean, you got something kicking that addictive system in your brain into action. And patients often use drugs or drink when they're taking Suboxone. One of the most discouraging things to me is that probably 80 or 90% of people on Suboxone just won't engage in any recovery work. It's almost as if they had a Suboxone awakening instead of a spiritual awakening. And their reliance for the recovery is totally dependent on the drug. What finally drove us to stop using Suboxone at the Private Center for Recovery was a change in leadership. And the fact, I think the nail in the coffin was that we began getting telephone calls from people asking us to take them off Suboxone. And that is one heck of a job. I mean, the withdrawal that the guy was describing is bad. It's really tough. And for me personally, as a physician, one of the things that I hated about it was that it fundamentally changed the relationship between me and my patients. Whether I liked it or not, I became a drug supplier for my patients. I was no longer an advocate for recovery. And that just destroyed me. I mean, I just couldn't live with that. Yeah, go ahead.
I'm a nurse here and I work in an ICU. We actually have had several moms come through. One particular mom, I remember last year, had gotten the Suboxone on her own, thinking that was in her best interest of her baby. And we found out about it, you know, shortly after the baby was born and was having withdrawal symptoms. But we're also seeing babies dependent on Suboxone and having to put them on medication.
I mean, Suboxone does everything. It produces opioid-induced hyperalgesia. All the side effects, they're all there with Suboxone. It's a narcotic. Yeah.
I had a client who became intermittently addicted on Suboxone and on heroin, going from one to the other.
Yep.
He became a dealer for it. His wife was killed by one of the people who he could not supply because he was not able to get Suboxone. He ended up being jumped, taken into a hospital, stayed there 3 months, they released him, he was jumped again, and finally they took him out of state for his own safety.
Yeah, so, you know, I mean, I think you probably, what you're already telling me is that what I saw coming 5 years ago is that Suboxone was not working, as all the promises that had been held up to us, as far as I was concerned, were empty dreams and nothing else.
When Suboxone, from what I recall, it was supposed to be like a 7 or 8 day thing, and then you're off it, wasn't it? How did it end up? Because I took it when I was in there in 06, and after 7 or 8 days, I thought I was going to lose it, and I was fine. But then I see other people, and you know, I was back, I do more research, and back out. But I see people that use it, and I mean, 2 years, 3 years, I mean, it's like a method.
Now that's unusual because, you know, when I first started and I thought for myself, you know, I'll give it to people for 6 or 7 days, and it just didn't work for anybody. Okay? It didn't work for anybody that I, maybe it was me, I don't know. But I just couldn't get it to work that way. So my thought was, well, let's try and use it on the long term, get people away from the lifestyle, get them, you know, working, get them productive, get them feeling better about themselves, and then we'll taper it off. And then what I found out was it's impossible to taper the darn stuff off. Nobody could do it. The withdrawal was horrendous. So, I don't know, does that help at all? Or?
Yeah, well, just, like I said, I don't know. I remember it was Easter Sunday, 2006, and I got panicked because I went there Sunday morning. Well, where's my pill? Like, Dad lost dog. I said, what have you done today?
So, you know, if you look at opiate withdrawal, there's an acute withdrawal. For example, heroin, let's use heroin as the prototype. There's a very severe withdrawal that lasts, acute withdrawal that lasts about 3 to 5, usually about 5 days. So, in about day 2 or day 3, most people hit the wall and they can't get through it at all. It starts to subside by about day 4. And by day 5, people are no longer throwing up and soiling themselves every time they stand up and are able to eat enough that they're not getting dehydrated. Okay? And then kicks in the post-acute withdrawal. And you've probably always all heard about pause in relation to alcohol, but pause in opiates lasts about anywhere from 30 to 90 days, depending on how much you were using and what opiate you were using. And that withdrawal is primarily irritability, anxiety, insomnia, and fatigue. And that just kicks people. It kicks them in the rear end and they can't deal with it and they go back to using again. So that's just why I think that one of the reasons why most people just don't make it with 6 or 7 days of Suboxone. Because you still got another 2 or 3 weeks or three or four weeks of post-acute withdrawal to get through. That's just miserable. Yeah, I'm sorry? They don't develop a tolerance to it. What happens is that 16 milligrams is where about 95% and after hit a ceiling to it. Almost everybody that I see, though, has tried to bump it up from there. up to 32 milligrams, 64 milligrams, and more. So if you have to remember, Suboxone is a very potent drug. 1 milligram of Suboxone is about equivalent to 10 milligrams of morphine. So we're really dealing with a very potent narcotic, and the tolerance happens very early. Most of the people that are receiving Suboxone from a physician already have a huge tolerance. So the tolerance is already there. But if you start using it, a 2 milligram film or whatever, right away, then you will develop a tolerance, yes, and you'll go to fours and then eights, and then, but at 16s, you're going to be looking for heroin because you're not getting the kick you like out of it.
Second question would be, in my experience, and I've talked to a couple other people, shared this with you, it's not
a
very large sample group, but.
Say again?
Buprenorphine can have a higher affinity than the naloxone in
suboxone. Does it have a higher? No. For most people, no. I mean, that medicine, they tell us never say 100% for everything, but most people, naloxone and naltrexone both have a higher affinity for the mu receptor than does buprenorphine. So what do you do now? We do not use Suboxone for chronic pain. We do not use it for treatment of opiates. We use it in detoxification, and we get good management of the acute withdrawal, and after people get through the acute withdrawal, then we're able to help them deal with the post-acute withdrawal symptoms using non-narcotic, non-addicting medications. And this is huge from my standpoint. Again, back in the 80s when I began working in this field, and all we had was catapress for detox, we'd lose about 50% of people during the acute withdrawal. And we'd lose about another 25 to 30% of people during the next 5 days of withdrawal. So we were losing 80 to 90% of people that didn't make it through detox. Now we're down to about 15%. And we can do that using Suboxone, and people are drug-free. The only people that we're keeping on Suboxone at the present time are pregnant patients. However, I need to tell you that there's actually been a recent paper written that's describing that it's safe to detox pregnant patients from opiates during pregnancy if you do it slowly, and that they don't have the kind of complications that you see if people quit using opiates abruptly during pregnancies. This is a group out of Texas, and I applaud them. They're swimming against the current here. But they're showing that you can take pregnant women, take them off of opiates, and their babies have very little withdrawal syndrome. So this is something to keep an eye on in the future.
Is there a common name that Suboxone is sold under?
I'm sorry?
Is there like a trade name Suboxone is sold under, or when you go get it at the pharmacy, it's only ever called Suboxone?
No, there are different formulations nowadays. So there's the generic, buprenorphine, naloxone is a generic, and there's Suboxone. And then they have some things like Subsys, which are out, and a few other people doing like knockoffs on it. But it's all the same. So if you remember that as buprenorphine and naloxone, those are the active ingredients in this combination. So then we get down to this drug down here, naltrexone. This is it right here. Vivitrol. Vivitrol contains only one drug, that's naltrexone. Naltrexone is a pure narcotic antagonist, which means it has no narcotic activity at all. It has a tighter affinity for the mu receptor than almost any other narcotic around. So nothing knocks it off. So it was brought out in 85 as an oral tablet to treat heroin addicts. And it's successful because people try and use on it, opiates on it, just doesn't have any effect at all. Of course, it doesn't prevent them from using other things. Where we saw the biggest success with this was in health professionals and lawyers and judges who were being monitored and having drug screens, which would pick up all the weird stuff people can use and get away with. As Vivitrol, is administered once a month by injection, and it, unlike the oral formulation, it actually does make a dent in the craving for opiates, and I've had people tell me that probably it's around 30%, 30 to 40%, but that's huge. We don't have anything else available that makes a dent in opiate cravings like that. The problem is, most people, when they stop taking it, relapse. So I want to take you back in history and talk about that. It's one of the reasons I don't like medicalizing addiction treatment. This is The Wonderful Wizard of Oz by L. Frank Baum, right? And it was written and published in 1900, right? Now that's the time of the first opiate epidemic, right? And here we are. The yellow brick road and the Emerald City, and in between is a field of
poppies.
Yeah, never think about that. So they start walking through, right? And these are the genetically susceptible members of the company. Okay? They start to succumb. One down, one to go. They're looking a little concerned, aren't they? And look at that. Oh, these poor codependents. So what do? They appeal to a higher power, right? Okay. Who does what?
Makes it rain.
Glinda the Good sends down snow, kills all the poppies, the fumes go away, and Dorothy and the lion revive, much to everybody's happiness. They go on a long and difficult quest, and eventually Dorothy gets home. So this was, I think, L. Frank Baum had the gist of the idea about 50 years before Bill W. did that wonderful work that he did with the 12 steps, right? And this is why people don't make it when you just try and medicalize the treatment of addiction, because addiction is a spiritual malady, and it requires a spiritual solution. And treating them with drugs is not going to cure addiction. That's all I got to say. Thanks a lot. So Mark or Jess, do you have anything more to say, or okay, or?
Nope. Please. Yeah, any questions?
Oh, question. I'm sorry.
Have you reduced acupuncture? Does that affect withdrawal symptoms or craving?
No, it helps a little bit with the anxiety, but not with much else, no. Yeah. And I actually been eager to someone to tell me about hypnosis, but I don't think that's going to work either. I mean, this stuff is all located subconsciously. It's just not going to be regulated like that.
So you're saying you do still use those Suboxone, but only on a short-term basis now?
But the longest that we have prescribed is about 6 days now, and that's for somebody using a couple grams of heroin for the last 5 years. Okay. So, you know, most people, a lot of people are off it in 3 days, 4 days, so, yeah.
You know, their Vivitrol blocks so you don't have the cravings to use.
It helps reduce the cravings. Okay.
Correct. Can't you OD though if you go for the physical thing?
That's a pharmacological property. So say that you buy 100 grams of heroin and inject it. Well, you'll probably die. You won't get high, but you'll turn off your respiratory center. Yeah.
Well, that's
And one of the other bad things about Vivitrol one of the things that Vivitrol does is it resets the density of the opiate receptors in the brain back towards normal, whatever normal is. Okay, and in doing that, when people stop using Vivitrol, and if they go back to using what they were using before, they will overdose and die. So that's one of the real problems in using Vivitrol is you have to get people into recovery before they stop using it.
What would you say would be let's say everybody got off the Vivitrol and everything else. Is there, there's got to be a time frame to straighten out all the highway up in the brain. Is there 90 days of a year type thing so they can kind of get that thinking out of it?
Well, I'll tell you, if you look at pupillary responses to light, one of the things that opiates do is, they cause the pupils to get real small. So when you take an opiate addict and they're clean for 2 years and you take them to see the ophthalmologist and the ophthalmologist measures the response of the pupils to light, they're still abnormal 2 years after. Okay. All right, so things get back to normal and people function and they do well and the craving goes away, 6 months, a year, 2 years, but you know, you can still detect abnormalities for a long, long time afterwards.
Are there antidepressants that have similar adverse effects that some of such drugs that we've discussed have?
Well, almost all antidepressants have some kind of discontinuation syndrome that's unpleasant. The difference being that I've never seen anybody do IV Paxil. Well, maybe it'll happen, but I haven't seen anybody do that. So these drugs don't turn on that addictive part of the brain. But, you know, if you take blood pressure medicine to stop it right away, you can get rebound hypertension, die of a stroke, too. So, you know, again, medicines are, you have to be careful with medicines. That you can't, a lot of them you can't just stop immediately.
So doctors are still going to prescribe maintenance drugs like Suboxone, Naltrexone for a long time, but you know, some degree. So in your opinion, since you've seen it in the field and read more research, do you think it's like against your Hippocratic oath or morally wrong to have patients on a maintenance drug like that when the study is designed?
Well, you know, one of the things that really worries me is that we run a MAPS report on everybody who comes into treatment. And I like running MAPS reports, so I'm usually the one that does it every morning. So I'm getting, you know, 10 to 15 reports, and these MAPS reports, anybody knows what those are? They're a record of all your controlled substances that you've been prescribed. And I can't tell you the last time I saw a physician prescribing only Suboxone. I mean, you go to a Suboxone doctor, they're handing out Adderall and Xanax and Clonopins, and now the latest thing to hit is a lot of people starting to use Valium again. I mean, this is really crazy. But, no, I don't like it. It's just a, you know. Yeah, it's really hard, again, to preach recovery when you're giving a drug which keeps somebody addicted. It just, I don't understand exactly why that works. Maybe some psychologist can help explain that to me, but it just doesn't really work real well.
So in an effort to move away from using drugs and to cure addiction, I wonder about two things. The technique of this neuroplasticity where you create new pathways, mm-hmm. or these old pathways that are there for still years and years, even on the drug maintenance type of thing, those pathways are still there. But creating new pathways as an alternative to drug maintenance. And also, I didn't quite catch that last sentence. You said that addiction is a spiritual something and something.
Malady. M-A-L-A-D-Y.
Malady, and yeah. Then you said something after that. Addiction is a spiritual malady.
And requires a spiritual recovery.
A spiritual recovery. Yeah. Thank you.
At least there's something to that effect. And as far as neuroplasticity goes, I think neuroplasticity occurs, and it occurs, that just means your brain becomes able to do things differently. And it does that, we see that in recovery. I mean, the best example of neuroplasticity is somebody 5 or 10 years in recovery. But addiction is a strange disease. It's, to my mind, it's like riding a bicycle. You learn how to do it when you're 5 years old. When you're 16 years old, you put it in the thing, and you never pull out again until you get your first DUI. And then you pull it out again, it takes you how long to learn how to ride a bike again? And addiction's just like that. It's just sitting there waiting to happen again. All it needs is exposure. Yeah. You have to speak real loud. I'm sorry, I have some hearing problems. It's used for alcoholics. There are a subgroup of alcoholics where it decreases the craving for alcohol. And we've seen that. That was one of the original observations by the people down in Yale who were using it, and Patrick O'Connor and his group. And for that reason, they got it approved for the treatment of alcoholism. It does work in some people to help reduce cravings for alcohol, yes. What does it do, you mean? Yeah, I don't know. That's one of the big mysteries, is why an opiate blocker should reduce alcohol craving. But it does happen. It does reduce alcohol craving. That's all it does. You don't get sick if you drink on it. It just simply reduces the craving for the alcohol. One of my friends who used it described it, well, better yet, when it first came out for the treatment of alcoholism, I had a guy come into treatment who had been relapsing four times in the past year. And he was doing everything right. He was going to meetings. He had a sponsor. He was working the program, but he just couldn't get past, you know, about 35 days sober. So in December, he came in for his fifth treatment. And I said to him, you know, they've got this new drug out there for treatment of alcoholism. And he says, you know, I'll try anything. So I didn't know much about it, so I gave it to him. So he came back in 30 days to get, you know, a renewal on the prescription. And I said to him, well, how are you? And he says, you know, he looked pretty good. He says, I feel great. I says, well, you know, what that medicine? He says, oh, I really like that medicine. And I thought to myself, uh-oh. And I said to him, and why do you like that medicine? He says, because I watched the Super Bowl. And I thought, man, I got to call the little men in white coats. What's all this about? And he looked at me and he just laughed. He says, Dr. Berger, you don't understand us alcoholics. He said, I've been watching the Super Bowl for 20 years. And for 20 years, all I see is 4.5 hours of Clydesdales. He said, but you know, this year, I actually saw the quarterback throw the football the very next play. And that's what naltrexone does when it works. It helps decrease that triggering the craving for alcohol. So, yeah.
So I don't have a drug question, but I was curious about your opinion on abstinence.
On what?
Abstinence.
Okay.
I was curious on your opinion about it, because the rest of the world is not about that, but they don't enforce it. But you started your lecture saying that you are in favor of it.
Abstinence-based 12-step recovery means that I, as a physician, will not prescribe any drug which is potentially addictive. So if you come to me telling me that you're in recovery and you want Adderall to help you do better in school, I'm going to tell you to take a hike. I mean, I'm not going to be nasty about it, but basically you're not going to get it from me. Or if you tell me that you want Ambien to sleep, you aren't going to get it. Or if you tell me you want Absinthe, you're not going to get it. Whatever you want that's potentially addicting, I'm not going to give it to you. I'm going to help you protect your recovery, because I'm not going to prescribe anything which is going to endanger your recovery.
Anyways, why do doctors, you know, because I go to Brighton Hospital every Saturday night for the patients, why do doctors prescribe so many different things, like you were saying, the Xanax, the pain, this, that, and the other? I mean, even the Clonopin and the Xanax, all that together, do they not know, or do they think they're doing good, or is it about the money?
So if you look at the health professional recovery programs that look at doctors who do things like that, there's usually a limited number of answers. One is the doc is a crook. The second is the doc has a problem himself. The doc is ignorant, or the doc is an enabler. So usually it's one of the four things. Yeah.
At the end of 2011, I had some very minor surgery, and they put me out when I came back. It was almost euphoric. It felt great. Last year, however, 2 years later, I had a pacemaker implant, and again I was put out, but I didn't get that same euphoric feeling when I came to again. Did something change in between, or is there something addictive what I had in 2011?
Yeah, I can't answer, but you know, it's interesting speculation. Something changed. They used different drugs. I'm not sure. The setting was different. Just don't know.
You said Ambien is addictive.
Oh yeah.
Well, okay.
My friend Mike Mayo Smith calls Ambien a non-benzodiazepine benzodiazepine, which I think is an accurate thing. In other words, it belongs to the same class of family as Valium, does the same thing Valium does.
Is there something you take for insomnia?
Yeah, see a good addictionist. We use lots of different things. We use gabapentin, we use trazodone, we use quetiapine. We use some older antidepressants. There's lots of things. And, you know, some people need a sleep study. I mean, do you have sleep apnea? Is that why you're not sleeping? Or is there, you know, something else that's going on? Are there tricks that you can learn for your sleep hygiene that will help you? I mean, some of this can be sorted out with a good sleep study.
So that's what I do with insomnia. So I think what I was told is that people worried for me, and they didn't want me to get a long-term addiction towards the particular drug, but you said trazodone is...
Yeah, again, but I would see someone because, you know, there's lots of things that cause insomnia. And some of the depression can cause insomnia and needs to be treated. And there's lots of different things that can cause it. So
I've had it for so long. I've tried to. I've done everything that I can think of. Okay.
Yeah, I hear you. But I can tell you the two things. I can't tell you the number of people that are coming in with Ambien as one of their drugs of choice. And the second thing is that we've had lots of people coming in using 40, 50, 60 milligrams of Ambien because it's become their drug of choice. So it just is not worth it. Yeah?
Are these drugs allowed to be marketed directly to the consumer as opposed to just marketing to doctors?
Which kind of drugs?
The legal opiates.
The legal opiates. They're allowed to be marketed, however, well... You can't legally buy them without a prescription.
But they can be, are they only marketed to doctors and prescribers?
No, they're marketed direct to the public, too, yeah.
Okay, just a follow-up. Do you have an opinion on the legislation that allows so many of these drugs to be marketed directly to consumers as opposed to only marketed to doctors? There's a change, I think, in the point.
If I had a great study repeated several times that proved that marketing did drive up the use of opiates, then I would be able to give you an answer. But I tell you, at this point in time, the way most people get addicted to opiates is they're taking somebody's prescription out of a medicine cabinet. And they start with a Vicodin 5, and it goes to Vicodin 10. And then they need more, so they're taking an Oxy. And then the oxys get too expensive, so someone says, why don't you snort some heroin? So they do it for a dime bag. And then all of a sudden it's three dime bags, and they can't afford it, so then they go and say, if someone says to them, why don't you put a needle in your arm, and you go back to using a dime bag again. And that's the way the whole epidemic goes. It's not because of direct-to-public marketing. It's because of there's so much of this stuff flooding all over. Vicodin is one of the most commonly prescribed drugs in the United States. That's what the problem is.
I have a question related to that. What do you think of hydrocodone going to schedule 2 next month? Do you think that's a good thing or a bad thing?
It's going to make it more difficult. I mean, in the past, Mary Smith could call her doctor and said, you know what, my dog ate my prescription for Vicodin. And the doctor could call the pharmacy and say, oh, I want Mary Smith to get another 666 tablets of Vicodin and to give her 5 refills on it. And that kind of thing is going to be impossible now because Mary Smith is going to have to come to the office and pick up a prescription, a paper prescription. It can't be faxed, it can't be e-prescribed, it can't be called. So it's going to make it much more difficult for drugs to be diverted and for people to use that kind of crazy stuff going on. So it's a good thing, we'll see. I mean, I'm not a public policy expert at all, so I don't really know. Say again, though.
I know before it was a Schedule 3 because I had like another analgesic over-counter, like acetaminophen or ibuprofen. So it's going to be Schedule 2 regardless if I have the addition of that.
That's right. So Zohydro came out and it's just pure hydrocodone. No, it's any fine hydrocodone, whether it's with the Vicodin, whether it has ibuprofen with it, whether it has acetaminophen with it, whether it's just straight alone, it's all of it Schedule 2 now.
Feldenkrais or rapid eye movement would be effective or would at least help in some of these addictions?
Help with?
Well, just help maintain sobriety and serenity, or that people would get the high from dying.
You know, I've learned most of my wisdom in life from AA. Mm-hmm. And they say, if nothing changes, nothing changes. Mm-hmm. Okay, so in the sense that if nothing is changing, you're going to be an addict for the rest of your life. But when you start to enter into recovery, you start doing things and becoming a whole person again. So yes, you do resume things like bicycle riding. You do resume exercising. You do start doing this, that, and the other thing that you've never done before, that you did before, and you've given up as a result of your addiction. But is that going to cure the addiction? No. I've never seen that cure addiction ever.
Can I briefly mention there is a program on mindfulness by Libby Robinson that's coming up in October. I can give you information outside if you want.
Thanks, Jess.
Mindfulness and recovery. She's done seminal research on that.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. Yeah. My goodness, you guys making me earn my keep tonight. Go ahead.
You ended this discussion and everything with that statement about spirituality. Could you kind of explain why it is that you boldly ended with that? I just wanted to know what your opinion was about that.
About?
You ended with the spiritual, how did you, the quote?
You need a spiritual awakening.
Yeah,
Oh, goodness. Yeah, I've never seen anybody go into recovery. And again, this is 30 years as a non-addict, helping addicts. I've never seen anybody really enter recovery without having some kind of spiritual awakening.
Spiritual is not religious. That's where people get hung up. I've heard people say that, I'm not going to a religious program. Spiritual is not necessarily
it, this is what we use to make decisions. This is what we use to get us through life. When this is sick, we need help. Okay? Because what we're using is sick and it makes bad decisions. I mean, that's what the whole thing about all this influencing the prefrontal and frontal cortex. When you have a disease process that interferes with normal decision making, all of a sudden it becomes perfectly obvious that going to the bar and having one drink is something that you can do, although you've never been able to do it before. It's obvious, you can do it, because what's making that decision is part of the disease. So you need something higher than yourself to bring some sanity back into your thinking. Okay. Yeah, okay. I'm sorry?
Julia Ross, she wrote the Moon Cure.
Okay, no, I didn't. I'm sorry, I don't know the author. Sorry. No. Okay, anything else? One more? Okay, one more.
This is a simple one.
He's been silent all night. Okay, go ahead.
This is a simple one. It's going way back in your discussion. But the point that I'm getting at is if I were given an opiate, let's say Vicodin, for an extended period of time, enough to relieve pain, you're saying that I will become addicted in a certain period of time, and dependent. But there's a distinction between dependent and addicted. But that, regardless, I'm just asking. You're saying 100% that's true.
Now, let me tell you. Okay, so
in other people, in other areas that I've listened to, they say it's a subset. Okay.
Okay. So there's a subset, but the subset, there's a subset that happens with initial exposure. For example, I have pretty severe migraine headaches, and one time I was given some codeine with Tylenol, and I come from a long family of alcoholics and addicts. So, and I remember that I had a really severe stomach. My stomach felt like somebody was twisting it like this after I took the codeine. But I felt so good, I thought this was almost worth it. Okay, my wife got Vicodin after a surgery, took one tablet and said, "This is the most awful stuff in the world," and threw it out. I'm glad she threw it out. I didn't want it around. I didn't want it to get tempted by it. So there's that initial exposure susceptibility. If you think of it sort of like what they used to talk about the type 1 and type 2 alcoholics. Some people get alcoholic after one drink, some people after 30 years of drinking. But I think that same thing happens with narcotics. And the problem is, remember, this is not taking place on a conscious level. And what I see people coming in telling me, "I'm not addicted to the stuff. I'm not getting high on it." But they've learned to wrap their entire life around taking that pill. And that's what addiction is. Where your whole purpose in living becomes centered around taking and getting a substance. So yes, and that's very hard to tease out for people who aren't aware of what's happened to them. Okay, well, thank you all very much.
Thank you. I've enjoyed being here.